management of vascular malformations in children. Vascular malformation is as a subject itself is galloping at a fast pace and going on to develop onto a specialty. The main advances that has occurred because of the development is mainly in the understanding of the biology of the lesions. Since the inception of biological classification by Mulliken and Glowacki, it has grown up as a big specialty, and now under the aegis of International Society for Study of Vascular Anomalies, it's been considered as a separate specialty for vascular malformation. By understanding the pathology, we have been able to understand what disease processes are and what management each condition requires, and grouping them, we have been able to develop better care for this group of children. So what the present classification says is, for the vascular anomalies, it is completely divides into simply into two categories. One is benign lesions, vascular tumors on one side, and the rest of them are vascular malformations. So vascular tumors, as we know, are benign lesions, are hemangiomas and the likes, and vascular malformations on one side can be of capillary lymphatic venous or a combination of them, as we see them grouped up as CVM, CLM, CAM, and there are other anomalies which would be like arteriovenous malformations or syndromic conditions. I'm not going to talk about the genetics or molecular biology. I'm going to discuss about the practical aspect of with the recent advances which can be implemented by people along in all their pediatric surgical setups. Coming to the vascular tumors, what has changed? The basic classifications remains the same. There is no more calling it as cavernous hemangioma. There is no more calling them as capillary hemangiomas. So you have hemangiomas on one side and capillary malformation. So the rest are capillary malformations. Under hemangiomas, you have the benign types, that is infantile, what we commonly see, and the congenital, which is a new category that has been introduced. Then there is a subgroup of them, which is locally aggressive and a malignant version. So coming to the congenital type, which I would like to highlight upon, that's the recent changes that has occurred in the classification. They've been classified as rich, that is, which stands for rapidly involuting congenital hemangioma, and other one would be partially involuting or non-involuting congenital hemangioma. They do behave as like a regular hemangiomas. Only thing that they are present at birth, and they can be large, and their treatment modality is the same, the propranolol, which has been taken over as a single used method for managing these conditions. But only thing is, the long-term outcomes, these tend to develop scarring, these tend to leave scarring, so you should be able to inform the parents future that would be requiring additional treatment, unlike regular infantile hemangioma, which whether intervene or not intervene, goes on to heal nicely with very little scars. The second type, what has been subcategorized, is partially involuting. Again, these congenital hemangiomas present at birth, but they tend to behave separately. They don't respond to propranolol, and they would better off being sclerosed or surgery, removed surgically, rather than waiting them, managing them for 6 months, 1 year, and going back and telling them that, yes, we will need to do surgery. So these are the two changes that has occurred in the treatment of infantile hemangiomas. So again, this is another one which I would want to highlight on. This again, a rapidly inverting congenital hemangioma presenting at newborn period with severe malformation. This is the present photo of the girl, which what you can see is significant amount of scarring that is still left in the child's face. The other thing I want to highlight upon before starting propranolol in this group of children is, any child with in the region of the trigeminal or in the upper facial, you need to do an MRI, because this group of children can have associated anomalies of the cerebral artery in terms of aplasia or hypoplasia. If you start propranolol, there is a very high risk of causing an ischemic stroke in this group of children, and you need to be careful, and you need to counsel the parents accordingly, or you need to do it under observation. That is another very important message. So what has changed in infantile hemangioma? Infantile hemangioma, the management remains same. The first standard would be propranolol. Again, those who are not managing them with propranolol or who are who are allergic to propranolol, or there is some complication to propranolol, you use steroids, and then the third line would be cyclophosphamide, vincristine, and so on. As with propranolol, it started, they said with a dosage would be twice daily or thrice daily. In the dosage of start with 1 mg, then go on up to 2 mg. That is the limit that most of the studies says. Coming to duration, that's another important aspect. Initially, it started at 3 years age, 3 months, then it went on to 6 months. But now most studies, and even our experience would say, you would want to cover up them during the period of growth. Like as we know, imagium as a birthmark, grows to some extent up to age of 1.5 years, then stays quiescent and regresses. So probably till the stage where it turns quiescent, you need to cover up them for management of this. Otherwise, you would have recurrence or come back and you have to restart the thing again. As far as complications in using propranolol, what we have seen mainly is GIT presenting as diarrhea, which we need to stop for a few children. But most of them are tolerated well. We've used this for children with congenital heart disease, of course, after proper echo and ECG. And children with those who are on seizure drugs and various other drugs, if you properly discuss with the pediatrician, and then you can definitely use this for that most benefit. The other imangema, that's the intermediate variant, what I would like to discuss is called caposiform imangema endothelioma. This again presents as an imangema, and this would be probably the way it would present in the newborn period. This is a more locally aggressive, and the present standard or current consensus would say you would need to have 2 drug therapy for managing this thing. Propranolol alone won't work, or steroid alone won't work if you're still using steroid. So you need to use propranolol with vincristine. The way to identify them, yes, this is sort of indurated. Probably they would be treated or worked up as cellulitis, managed with antibiotics. Then you do an ultrasound, then it shows a very vascular lesion. The clinching would be an MRI, which shows highly vascular lesion with the fat strangling with extension into the adjacent tissue. That's very indicator for it to be a hemangioma. Of course, biopsy also can be done. The other thing what you would do is look at the platelets. Yes, that would be something like 10,000 and 17,000, things like that. So you would initially you would start them with an injectable variant of steroid as a pulse dose or a continuous one. Then add propranolol, and if you're using vincristine, it's recommended up to use for about 16 weeks. This child was treated with propranolol elsewhere, came to us with severe edema, and we treated the child with the 2 drug of vincristine and steroid, and this is how at the last follow-up the child would look at. These are the common conditions which you would encounter and you would need to be aware of. So what else propranolol is used for? So people have looked around, since it started functioning well in managing of these lesions, people have looked around, can it be used for something else? Since 2014, there have been plenty of articles, mainly coming from Australia and China and also Japan, for extended use of propranolol for non-hemangiomatous conditions. Yes, we had our share of experience. This is one of the child, probably historical, Ram sir would know, this was probably first child born for exit procedure in Bangalore, and he had a very severe cervicofacial lymphatic malformation. He came to us at 2 years of age with a large malformation. Then we were reluctant to operate on him at that point. So after counseling with the parents and with proper consent, started propranolol on this child. What we found that was the whole tumor became softer and much easier to handle. The child underwent a stage surgery, first for submandibular, and this with the facial one, requiring total parotidectomy with, of course, compression support that forms the cornerstone in management of such conditions. And now, presently, is in this condition, is appearing like this. The other one we had was this child coming from Bengal with, she presented to us the OPD with multiple discharging sinuses from the perineum and the gluteal region. When we did ultrasound, we were surprised to see it was a lymphatic malformation, of course, and MRI also confirmed the same. But she had extensive extending into the abdomen surrounding the genital tracts. So other than giving antibiotics, there was not much we could do. So we offered the parents, yes, possibility of propranolol because of the recent articles which were there. And she did respond. This was at 6 months age, where she came back and all the sinuses healed. Of course, she still has the underlying condition to be managed, but as of now, she is taken care of the local complications of that, and she's been off propranolol. There were a few reports of AV malformation. We used them. This was child again worked up at Chennai. The child coming from West Bengal, extensive worked up. It showed a very aggressive lesion. We discussed with our pediatric cardiologist from Jaideva for embolization and subsequent surgery, but they were reluctant on that. So again, this child also went on to receive propranolol, and I don't have the last picture of that, but it is received, it has completely regressed, and she is now just on observation, and she is effect of the surgery of the same. The other conditions, what we are routinely seeing now is extensive lesions of lymphatic malformation with associated, this is a CL malformation because this has a capillary mark here, that's a capillary malformation associated with the extensive involvement of the lower limb. This is a lymphatic malformation. This presented a newborn period. Again, the MRI depicting the same is diffuse edema in the subcutaneous region, not involving the muscles, of course, but we didn't want to do extensive or a debulking surgery in newborn period. This child also underwent, partook in that for propranolol therapy. Again, what we found in this group of children is when we see them at later age, the limbs are so hard and difficult to do surgery, but when they were on propranolol, the skin is soft and very malleable. And of course, the child was on compression garment throughout, and they still continues to wear that. And that surgery, we could debulk quite a bit of it, and stage now he has undergone the thigh surgery also. So these are some of the extended use of propranolol people have used, and definitely that is helpful in your management. Coming to lymphangioma, this is another condition which you routinely often see in your management. If you intend to sclerose them, yes, presently doxycycline is being used because in the management of this malformations. Doxycycline, again, previously it was not, as injectable form was not available in India. Now recently, since 1 year or past 2 years, it is there. The doxycycline, per se, is better, reported better because for bleomycin, we know the toxicity of lung involvement, so that probably it avoids that. So doxycycline can be switched out to doxycycline. Again, you'll have to know the disadvantage of doxycycline would be effect on tooth and bones that you need to be aware of. So presently we are doing a randomization of using doxy and bleomycin in our institute. So we still can't be able to tell about the superiority of the drugs. Coming to another malformation again, venous malformation. This is again very common in your clinical practice. You see them, they're again benign lesions, or sometimes it could be severe based on the extent of it. They present to you with pain, swelling or limitation of movement or disfigurement depending on where they are. So again, sclerotherapy again. This was one article which came up in seminars in pediatric surgery. Very good article. This whole series 2014 contains a lot of articles on vascular malformation. You should read it up. It gives a lot of insight into management of this condition by Das Gupta. These are from team from Cincinnati. They described the sclerosing technique, which are very simple and which can be applicable, which can be reproducible at all centers. So superficial lesions, we just give direct intralesional therapy with sodium tetradecyl. Deep lesions are done under CM guidance. So these are some of the superficial lesions which we have done with the lip, simple lesions of the cheek where you can't offer them surgeries because it can amount to disfigurement. Again, lip and upper lip, these are under treatment still now. Over the limbs where this again, the children present with pain and the induration which limits their working or limits their movement. So by simple sclerotherapy, you can take care of these conditions. Coming to lower limb, you need a CM for that. You need CM access. You mark them with ultrasound. Then you access them with the scalp vein. Then we introduce this in contrast so we can document the malformation which matches what is seen on the MRI. Then you give the volume of sclerosin same as sodium tetradecyl sulfate, and they produce very good results. So these are some of the sclerose images which are accessed for a deep venous malformation of the limbs. This is involving the ankle where you can't have surgery other than doing flaps. Again, she responded well to injection sclerotherapy. Again, these are accessed to under CM and injected. Sometimes they come with severe deformity of equinus, where we have done with orthopedic colleagues, we do the injection for the soft muscle and then they do go with the tendo-chinous lengthening, and it definitely improves the mobility of these children. Any complications in sclerotherapy? Yes, we have had some complications. Mainly superficial, it can cause this marking. Or sometimes this one child, after sclerotherapy for deep systems, she came back with infection and superficial infection of the skin, and which was treated conservatively. So what I wanted to say is the vascular malformation, if you can understand the anatomy and the biology, you can improve the quality of care, and you can be comfortably done at your institutions, at your place, and definitely improve the conditions of these children. At this point, I would acknowledge one person who was instrumental in putting me into this specialty of vascular malformation. So I would thank you, sir, and of course our team at Indira Gandhi Institute. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gowri. You almost touched upon all the modalities of treatment for lymphovascular malformations. We can allow one question.
Sir, it was a nice talk. I'm Dr. Rachit. Is there, sir, any criteria of propranolol? Is there any age criteria that you should use it at a particular age only? Or can we use it in the age above than 12 years? Because most of the times the patient come to us at 10 years, 12 years, when they have that hemangiomas and vascular malformations like of thing. So is there any, can we start the propranolol at that time?
No, that's the thing I would want to tell you again. So understand the biology of it. So hemangioma only as disappears by 3 years. What comes after 10 years, 12 years, they are not hemangiomas. Probably you are looking at AV malformation. So AV malformation, some children, yes, they add benefit with that, but otherwise they are better off with surgical excision would be primary. Embolization, if possible, excision. Propranolol, if it is feasible, yes, you can use, but you can't use the term as hemangioma, so it would become a AV malformation. For starting age, yes, newborn can be started. We started at 3 days. It would require an admission. If you are starting a newborn age, rest of all, it can be done in OPD practice.
Usually the problem comes when the radiologist will tell you that so there the confusion occurs most of the time.
Yeah,
when you do the MRI and still they say that it is, they are not sure what exactly it is.
Yeah, that's a common problem. You get referred saying that it's an hemangioma. You see the diagnosis it's hemangioma, but it is not. It is either a venous malformation, you examine there are some plebolites, or it is a AV malformation. So you need to go back and educate them and tell them.
Thank you, John. Yeah.
Sir. Yes, sir. The mechanism. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes. Yes. The rationale for propranolol is propranolol works on what is endothelial growth factor, VGF. That's what it has been purported for. So similar cells have been identified in lymphatic and some variety of venous lesions. So when these are present, definitely they would inhibit the growth of the cells and by about that bring about change in them and help in management. That is the mechanism that has been thought of. As far as dose of infusion is the same as we use 0.05 mg per kg, that is what has been used. And the dosage is weekly dose given for 14 to 16 weeks. Vascular malformation, yes, we have used. I have not put up the images. We have had two children, one presenting with a newborn child, presenting with pancreatic lesion, very large lesion. When we did FNAC and IHE, it came out as vascular endothelium. So contrast we did, it was highly vascular lesion. So we started on propranolol and it did respond to this thing. So hemangioma of liver, I have not treated with propranolol. So visceral, two conditions of pancreatic lesions, we have treated with propranolol and they do respond well.